Hello everyone, today we are going to be walking through how you can build an image recognition model to recognize handwritten numbers in Python. I'm going to show you how you can do this using notebooks in the Azure Machine Learning Studio. And as we build the model, there's a couple of exciting notebook features that I want to show you. So first I'll walk you through how you can set up your environment. Then I'll show you some features that will help speed up your coding productivity. Then we're going to do some data exploration as well as model training. And once we finish this, I'll show you a number of features that can help you get your notebook to production. Lastly, I'll show you how to use the Azure ML SDK. And what the SDK allows you to do is to conduct your run remotely, or you can use it to register your assets to the workspace, like your datasets, your experiments, and your models, so that you can keep track of all the previous runs you've done. And if you'd like to refer back to them in the future, you can do so easily. So let's dive into the model. Today, we are going to be building a simple multi-class logistic regression using the MNIST dataset. This dataset consists of 70,000 grayscale images, all representing pictures of handwritten numbers, and each of these images consist of an array of 8x8 pixels. So the input of our model is going to be this array of 8x8 integers, where each integer represents the intensity of that pixel, and the output of our model is going to be the number between 0 and 9 that's written in that handwritten image. So now that you know how this model is going to work, let's switch over to the Azure Machine Learning Studio now. Before we begin, first you'll want to make sure that you have a running compute. And you can find that in the top right-hand corner here. If you don't already have a compute set up, you can easily create one using the new compute process. And from this window, you can select a virtual machine with the required hardware that you'll need. On the left-hand side here is our file explorer. So this is where all of our documents are stored. You can see our .ipynb notebook file here. This is also where you can find any supporting Python files, any YAML scripts, or if you upload any data SCSV, that can also be found here as well. I also want to point out that the Azure Machine Learning Workspace is a collaborative environment. So if you have coworkers who have access to the same workspace, their files will also be stored here as well. This makes for easy collaborative sharing. So if you want to share your notebook file with any coworkers, all you have to do is link them the URL to that notebook. I also want to show the terminal. And what the terminal allows you to do is access your Linux machine directly. So from this window, you can conduct any Git actions, such as cloning in any existing repositories, or you can also push your code to any remote repositories. You can also do any pip actions here. So if you're looking to update or install any packages, this can also be done through the terminal. So I'm going to enter focus mode here just to give us a bit more space to work with. So before we actually check the notebook contents, I also want to point out the table of contents, which allows us to look at a high-level overview of the contents of this notebook. So we know for today we are going to be doing some data exploration, some model training, and after that's done, we'll output the model. And each of these sections in the table of contents is designated by a markdown header. So if you click into that section, it will navigate you directly to that markdown header within the notebook. So let's jump back up to the top of our notebook. So the first two cells are for setup. We're going to import some packages, and then we're going to set up some function definitions. And then let's dive into the data exploration section. So the first thing we're going to do is download our MNIST dataset. And then we're going to take that dataset and split it up into our X and Y testing and training sets. And at this point, we're probably wondering what exactly is contained within these four variables. And how we might usually check is by printing either the variable itself or the shape to see that it actually contains the contents that we need. So instead of actually printing out this using code, what you can do is use the variable explorer, which provides a glimpse into the variables directly without needing to write that code. So the variable explorer gives information on all variables, including the data type, the size of that variable, as well as a peek into the value. So we can see here for our X and Y testing and training sets, the testing sets both contain 10,000 elements in that array, and the training sets contain 60,000. So you can see how those 70,000 images were split up. And you can see for the X variables, this contains that array of 8x8 integers, and the Y variable contains that integer between 0 and 9. So now let's randomly display a couple of images from the X training set. And you can see here that we've selected 30 random handwritten images displayed here, and directly above it is the corresponding number, which we are going to try to predict. So now we're ready to begin training our logistic regression model. Let's first set our regularization rate to 0.5, and then let's create a logistic regression class object and set this to multi-class. And here I want to point out a feature that's useful if you're working with a library that you aren't super familiar with. In this example, we're using logistic regression from the sklearn library. And if you aren't familiar with the parameters, there's a notebook feature that we have integrated with that provides help with things like autocompletions and function help. So if you start writing the name of the class, here we're typing logistic regression, IntelliSense suggestions will pop up providing suggestions, and you can tab or enter to autocomplete. And if you start typing open bracket, this gives a pop-up with hints as to what parameters are required to instantiate this class. So here you can see that some of these parameters that we had in our logistic regression class are appearing. So you can see multi-class, you can see random state, as well as our C value. And let's say you're reading a notebook that somebody else has written and you're not planning to write any of the code yourself, but you still want to understand what's written here. What you can do is hover over a class or a method, and this provides the full function documentation. So you can see here there's help on the parameters, as well as some attributes and examples. And this works for libraries beyond sklearn. So if we scroll up here and check out random from NumPy, this also provides the full function documentation, so you can read this directly within the notebook. And so let's run this, and while it's training, you might notice that the cell state for this particular cell has changed. And what this bar here indicates is whether a cell has been queued for running, whether it's currently running, or whether it has successfully run. And if a error occurs during the cell run, that will also be reflected in the cell status bar. So from a previous run, we've already generated a prediction. So we're going to store this prediction using this logistic regression model that we've just created and store it in a variable called y hat. And then we're going to take y hat and compare it to the actual values in y test to determine the accuracy. So from our previous run, we know that this model is able to achieve an accuracy rate of 92%. So we're quite happy with the results of our model. The last thing we're going to do is output that model. So I'm going to insert some code here to help us track our run. And as part of this run, we're going to log two metrics, our regularization rate and our accuracy. And once we have these two logged, this will help us send these two metrics to our AML workspace so that we can refer back to it later. And the last thing I'm going to do is output our model to a pickle file so that later we can send this to our model in our asset section in the AML workspace. So we've got our model now. Let's say we want to take this Python notebook and convert it to a script so that in the future we can send the script off to be run remotely. First, what we might want to do is take our notebook and clean up all of the exploratory work, such as displaying these variables and displaying these images. We'll probably want to take that out, and then we want to convert this to a Python script. For the first part, I want to point you to a feature named gather. And what gather does is determine all the code dependencies needed to generate a given output cell. And it'll gather all of that necessary code into a new notebook. So let's run gather on this final cell, which contains our model output, and it should take only the essential code. So as you can see in this new notebook, it only contains the required parts. So all of that data exploration and image outputs that we had generated earlier at the beginning of the notebook has all been cleaned out, and only the parts needed to generate a model remain. So at this point, our code is still in this .ipynb notebook format, and we want to convert it to a Python script. We can do that easily using the export feature, which you can find in this drop-down menu. And if you select Python from the export as options, this will compile all of your notebook code into a Python script and download that locally. And if you also want to share your notebook with non-notebook users, you can also export as HTML or as LaTeX. I mean, that just makes for easy collaboration. So I have a copy of this gathered Python file stored in my sklearnmnist directory already. So we're going to use this to send to a remote run. So I'll show you now how you can train this script remotely, as well as register your assets to the AML workspace so that you can refer back to them later here. I'm going to open up a new Python notebook which contains new code, and this notebook we're going to use exclusively to explore the AML SDK. So going back into focus mode, let's dive into the code here. So the first thing we're going to do is import the AML SDK, and we're just going to import azureml.core. And then we're going to specify the workspace that we're working in. And we can do this by reading in the contents of our config.json file and sending this to a workspace object here. So if you're not familiar with the AML SDK, we have some code snippets. And what the code snippet does is compile a list of common code excerpts from the AML SDK so that you can insert that code without having to remember what's required. So for this particular action, we're trying to configure our workspace. If you type config, you can see here the second option in this snippets menu is get workspace from config. So you can tab or enter to insert that code, and this will import all of the code needed to create this workspace object and read the contents of this config.json file. So the next thing we're going to do is register our dataset to the workspace so that we can access it later from here. And then we're going to create an experiment object and name this tutorial-sklearn-mnist. And when we check our experiments later, we'll refer back to this name. And then we're going to create our remote compute. So here we have an option. We can either train the script locally, which is what we did earlier using our local compute, or we can also take advantage of remote resources by creating a cluster of Azure virtual machines. So let's create a compute cluster. And I'm going to run the cell and then create a cluster named CPU cluster. We're going to refer back to this later when we set up our run configuration. So now we can set up the configuration to train on this remote cluster. First, we're going to create a new folder, and this is just the folder that contains our script, as well as any supporting files, so that the run knows where to refer to the documents. And then we're going to configure the training job. So let's create an environment first that contains all the necessary package dependencies. So we're going to specify here that we're using scikit-learn, and then we're going to set the package version. And then we're going to create our script run config object. And here we're going to specify the training script. So the training script is the image classification gathered Python script that we created. The compute target, which is the compute cluster that we had created earlier in the notebook, as well as this environment, which we have just specified. And then let's submit our run to the cluster. So while that's executing, I'm going to surface this run widget, and the widget is going to provide a real-time update on how the run's progress is going. And we can monitor this directly from the notebook. So that's going to take a while to run. These are the results from a previous run that I had conducted. And you can see here that we have logged a regularization rate of 0.5 and achieved that 92% accuracy. So we like these results, and the last thing we're going to do is register this model to the workspace so that we can refer back to it here. So we've logged a number of different assets to the workspace, so now we can go and check to see what those look like. If we navigate to datasets, this is where our mnist_open dataset is stored. You can see that in the datasets tab under experiments, this gives an overview of all the experiments that you have run, as well as details for each run. So if we click into our tutorial-sklearn-mnist, you can see that we have queued one run, which is the experiment that we had just submitted. And in the past, there have been 16 successful completions. So if you click into a specific run, it'll provide metrics for each of those runs. And if you had logged any custom metrics like we had, that will also be displayed with that run. So if you had done any sort of exploration with the parameters or changed anything up with the model, you can refer back to the results in this experiments section. And then lastly, we had registered our model to the workspace. And here you can find that we have our sklearn-mnist model. So that concludes this tutorial on how you can use the Azure Machine Learning Notebook and Workspace to build models to classify images. I hope you enjoyed the session, and thank you for your time.